Okay, today we are talking space planes. A very weird sci-fi sort of idea. They are not quite planes, they're not quite rockets, but hopefully they will be a cheap and quick way to get things to space. And the company we're gonna visit that's making one of these space planes is called Don Aerospace. They're based in New Zealand. One of the co-founders is a guy named Stefan Powell. The company's pretty young. They've just built their first prototype. And so with that, let's head way to the bottom of the world in Christchurch and talk to Stefan. We're at this interesting time, and you're in an interesting place when it comes to rocketry. There's a little bit of a race going on to make these small rockets that are cheap and that you could launch all the time. Rocket Lab, which has got its main operations in Auckland, is the clear leader so far. They're the only ones that have really launched. Then you guys have almost like an even more radical take on getting rapid access to space. So, I mean, give me the like 10,000 foot view of what Dawn's trying to do.
Yeah, so, I mean, Dawn is a space transportation company in a very general sense. You know, that's space launch, that's maneuvering things around in space, and eventually that means getting stuff back down to Earth as well.
And okay, and then in terms of like, getting stuff to space. I mean, you guys have this awesome space plane, and give me like sort of the specs on like the first one that you're building.
Yeah, so the first plane that we're building, the Mark II Aurora, is about 280 kilograms takeoff weight, about 2.5 meter wingspan, and it flies out of regular airports. That's the point. Our space plane will be certified under aircraft law. It'll fly as an aircraft. And so we will have a license to fly the vehicle as opposed to a rocket launch license for that one flight.
Yeah, well, and so for people that like know nothing about this, I mean, before every rocket launch, it's like you got to apply for this license, which is this whole timely and costly process, and then you got to clear the airspace, you got to clear the water.
And I mean, it is kind of reasonable because these rockets, the way they are now, they are pretty dangerous. Like, a lot of them do fail. But aircraft are different just because they have wings. You can completely lose all your propulsion, and you can generally still glide back. You know, it's not end of the mission.
So with this first space plane you guys are building, how much will you take to space? And then what's kind of the goal as you make bigger and bigger space planes?
Yeah, so the Mark II Aurora will be able to take 4 kilograms on a suborbital flight. The Mark III should be more like a business jet size. That'll be able to get about 50 to 100 kilograms into orbit. It ascends just like a really high-powered aircraft. By the time it gets to the edge of the atmosphere, it's flying pretty much like a rocket. Once it gets to about 100-ish kilometers altitude, it'll release a second stage, just like a regular rocket. That second stage is going to fly off into orbit and deliver a satellite. And then it can actually turn around and glide back to the launch site and land just like an aircraft.
In sci-fi, we read about the idea of a space plane all the time, but yeah, why hasn't somebody built one of these so far, and why do you guys think you could actually do this?
They actually did try to. The Air Force in particular started on space planes.
The X-15 roars free on a tongue of flame. That power is enough to shoot nearly 59 miles into space.
It eventually all fell over because we just had to go beat the rockets to space, you know, and the easiest way to do that was rockets. We revisited that with the space shuttle. You know, that's a huge space plane. That thing is massive. But actually it lost every element that would have made it an aircraft. In every other way, it was a rocket. It's just that it had wings for landing. There were then a whole bunch of other programs. But in the end, they all fell over because the government no longer wanted to back them. But the reason you can do a space plane project now is because of the small satellite market. You know, we don't have to build something capable of taking 20 tons to orbit. Hell, 20 kilograms would be fine. And then the amount of venture capital going into space now has gone up hugely. And so there is actually commercial appetite for this stuff. And it's this kind of confluence of things that makes space planes actually make sense now. I think the big inflection point for us is being able to show that, yeah, we have properly reusable space launch technology. We can go fly a plane that is a plane in every single way, but it has the performance of a rocket. And if we can do that basically on fuel costs plus a little bit of engineering time, that's the game changer, because you're going to cut your total flight cost by 96%.
The price you guys are talking about for a launch, I mean, say you've taken it from millions of dollars to thousands of dollars to get something into space, it sort of like opens up this new world to run all these experiments that people have been clamoring to do. We found that molecules do weird things when there's no gravity. We found that plants grow in strange ways, DNA behaves differently, and materials can be made to do different things.
Absolutely, and that's why we're working on such a far out technology. In-space manufacturing is gonna be the next big thing. You know, multi-trillion dollar industries could spawn out of this. We need space planes, or we need proper frictionless access to space to actually make this happen. We want to be able to make space more accessible. I mean, that's kind of our whole ethos. You know, space is kind of for everyone.
And I think I saw that you guys did this kind of cool thing where you put out as almost like a contest that people could do the design on the outside of the space plane. Was that just for students? How did that work?
No, it was open to everyone. We had students, like, you know, we had 10-year-old kids put in designs, as well as design studios and all kinds of people from all over the world. Space is something the whole world should be participating in. And so why not open that up to everyone else?
And you had a contest on the payload too, right?
Yeah. So the prize was actually that if you designed the winning paint job, it would fly a payload for you. But funnily enough, the company that won it didn't have too much interest in flying a payload, so we actually found another contestant that had the best payload, Centaurus School in Colorado, and they want to measure pollutants in the high atmosphere.
Were you like a space geek growing up and you knew you always wanted to do this? Like, what were you into as a kid?
No, like I wasn't really a space geek. I actually went to university thinking that I was going to get into sustainable technology. Wind turbines and whatever. But I actually got to the university and realized that there's not much practical stuff you can do with them. It's not particularly hands-on. But there was this really cool university group building rockets. I could get stuck in there and actually start building stuff and putting solid rocket motors together. It was an epic experience, yeah.
And one thing I wanted to talk about too is you guys, you want to make basically simpler, cheaper thrusters for satellites.
Yeah, so scalable, high performance, non-toxic chemical propulsion for CubeSats and small satellites. We can mass produce these, they're relatively simple, they're relatively easy to put together. They click onto their satellite and they can give mobility to their constellation. That's a mature product now. You can go online and buy it. We actually have it in our web shop. You can actually add to cart and buy a rocket motor with your credit card if you want.
So you guys have a couple things going on. You're doing the business around the thrusters. And then the biggest milestone is the space plane to start running some of these flight tests as soon as you can.
Yeah, exactly. If we're successful, that'll then be the first vehicle to ever be able to fly to space twice in a day. We think that's kind of the game-changing moment. That's the, like, okay, you know, we've actually got properly reusable space systems.